Hello, welcome to the Curator Podcast. This is episode 8. Hello, welcome in once again, dear listener, to the Curator Podcast. I'm your host, Mark Fraser, and this is episode 8. I hope that whoever's listening to this, wherever you're listening to this, you're doing all right. If you're listening to it in the car, if you're listening to it on the way to work, if you're at a run, if you're just sitting in front of your computer, doesn't matter. I hope you're doing okay. And if you're not doing okay, then you know what? You can always talk to me. I like talking to people, and really, I think I'm a good listener, so I mean, if you need somebody to talk to, don't be afraid to reach out, man. It's important, it's valuable, it's great, so I mean that sincerely, honestly. I like connecting with new people, so yeah, if you want to do that, I'm your ears, I can be your ears, I'm okay with that. I've actually had a pretty good couple of days. My podcast is now in the new and noteworthy in iTunes, so I mean, that's just fucking great. Thank you everybody who rated it and reviewed it and listened to it and downloaded it. It's been phenomenal. I'm kind of blown away. I don't really know what else to say. It's, it's been a big honour, but honour's not the word. It's been surprising. I didn't think it would happen, but it has. So, from the bottom of my heart, thank you very much. It means the world to me. On today's episode, we have Lags and Stuart from Gallows. This is a really good interview. We talked a lot about Venn Records, a lot about Gallows, just generally over the years, I guess, and a little bit about their sort of inspiration and their influences, and kind of, you know, you do get a sense of them as people being just really passionate about music and about their music, which is, it's always awesome when that comes through. The rest of the band were in the room at the time, but they didn't say anything at all. The music that you can hear in the background is actually Departures, who were playing during the recording, so you should check them out as well. They're dead good. But yeah, Stuart and Lags, lovely guys, they're really engaging fellows, and I hope you really enjoy it. For me, Gallows are probably one of the most important punk bands that Britain's produced, not just in the past 10 years, but, you know, ever. I don't think that's hyperbole to say that, I think that's genuinely true. One of the reasons that I'm a musician is partly because of Orchestra of Wolves, which I heard many years ago, and before I seen the band after this interview, the last time I'd seen them was supporting Rage Against the Machine in 2010, and they were a totally different band back then in terms of personnel and everything. So it's really good to see them evolve and to hear their sound evolve and just to see them change, I guess, as people. And now they're much busier. They certainly seem to have a lot of fun on stage, and I had a lot of fun during this interview. I need to thank Davey Rees, one of my pals, for helping me do the sound, because I've never interviewed two people before, and for providing me with an extra microphone for those extra voices. So yeah. But before we get into that, I'm going to play a track by Gallows. This is from their new album, Desolation Sounds, and it's called Chains. Also, I wanted to say that because they spent some of the interview talking about Venn Records, I've broken up the interview with a track from Milk Teeth from their EP Sad Sack. This track is called Vitamins, and I hope you like that as well. It's very different from Gallows, but it's very fucking cool, and you can get that on Venn Records. So yeah, here we go. First off, Chains, then Interview, then Milk Teeth.
Disappears, east vanishes. gentlemen.
Good evening.
You guys have been pretty busy, like, especially you guys, because you're not just Gallows starting back up now, but also like you've got a label and you've got a management thing. So 2015 is looking quite busy for you guys. So now that Gallows are back in action, is it quite hard to balance like both sides of?
It's hard to do Gallows because everyone's so far apart. But when it comes to doing the record labels, you know, it's a lot of it's just email.
Yeah.
Or like, do you know what I mean? Like, constantly, like,
you're picking up most quick. Open the noisiest snack you can, Wade McNeil. It's a bag of salt and vinegar Walkers for anyone who is bothered. And that is a branding opportunity there. So if you want to send us free crisps, please do. No, I mean, I mean, it's a valid question. Venn was started when we were all in the same country together and were touring heavily. Since we've been touring less heavily, the labels actually got busier.
Yeah.
So when we were all together, the first band that we signed was Marmosets. We put out their first 7-inch. I think that was after we played, was it Sonisphere or Download?
It was at Download.
Download. And we saw them and we were just like, who's this unknown band? They're going to be amazing. Let's give them a platform, which is something that we never had, really. For Gallows, we kind of put out our own demo before we got an album deal. So we were really pleased to do that, and it worked. It was easy. When Gallows was busy touring a lot, it was kind of a lot easier to discover bands that we wanted to sign because we'd be playing with them a lot. And I think since we've geographically spread out with Wade in Canada, myself in California, and Lags here in London holding it down, we tend to have a bit more of a global approach with it on the label now. Whereas before, I think still, we've only released UK bands so far, right?
We've done a couple of Norwegian bands.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
But again, because Gallows have always had quite a big fan base in Norway, it's like it's a country that just gets it. And you can tell by the kind of bands that get huge there. Do you mean like Cavell Attack, Turbo Negro, like all those bands, you know, they're big influences on us.
Joe Ewing were a huge influence.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah. So it's like, so for us, like signing bands from Norway, it's almost like signing bands from home because, you know, a lot of this, me and Wade were saying actually, like the other day, there's a huge demand for Gallows in Norway, and I think it's just because they kind of get that kind of music.
Yeah. London never got us, or the UK rather, really never got us. I mean, it sounds ludicrous to say because we had a certain degree of success in the media and commercially. But really kind of our peers that we looked for and the scene that we felt we fit in more is definitely in like Oslo, basically, in Norway. So it's strange. That's where we took our key influences from.
Yeah, when Gallows first started, there was so much influence from Scandinavia and less so from like, you know, the UK hardcore trends where there's a lot of beatdown metal and...
And those are all bands we're all friends with, you know, and bands we grew up listening to and going to see at shows. Nothing against it, but when we wanted to do something different, I think we were excited by what was going on in Scandinavia, in Sweden and Norway, especially with labels like Burning Heart, for example, who put out bands like Nine, Within Reach, Breach, J.R. Ewing were on... who put out our first J.R. Ewing records?
J.R. Ewing did stuff with a guy from Coalition.
Coalition. And so these are all labels and bands that we looked to that wasn't happening where we were from, so it was exciting and new. And that's what we try and do with Venn, really, is just kind of sign bands that aren't just your run-of-the-mill, you know, a dime a dozen kind of bands. So we signed Marmosets, and obviously they've gone on to great things. We put out a release from Moose Blood, who are obviously doing really well. So we're not defined to one kind of style, we just put out music that we like. And I think that answers your question in a really roundabout way.
Oh, I was actually going to say, like, yeah, it seems like you guys are starting like a sort of DIY punk empire almost. Like,
I think that's almost a contradiction in terms of a DIY empire. It's funny. I think we just have, without wanting to sound big-headed, I think that being around as long as we have, we think we know what good bands are, what bands approach their art in a way where they're going to have some kind of longevity. And I think the minute that Lags and I and Way and we first saw Marmosets play and the way they put their heart and soul into it, we thought there's a band that's going to have some longevity. I think with Moose Blood, completely different stylistically, but the way that they present their music and lyrics, we were like, that's a band that's going to have some longevity. And the same with Baby Godzilla, you know, and that's another band we released. They don't leave a show without being bloody and bruised, and you're going to see that tonight here at the Cat House in Glasgow. They are just a band who go all out. So any band who presents their art in that fashion, Venn tends to get behind it.
Yeah, it's weird, because I've had messages from people who are at, I won't say where, but like big publishing companies who are like, oh, just picked up this band, you know, can you check them out? We want to do something with them, like trying to find like a cool label to put them out through. They send it to me and I'm like, oh my gosh, it's just such like, there's no edge, there's nothing about them. It's just the reason they're getting kind of this major backing is simply because like they're
safe.
Yeah, completely safe, completely sellable. And like, I think our market is people like us. Do you know what I mean? It's not like the general music fan. It's like people that represent what we do, what we're into, the kind of art we like, the kind of bands we listen to. So it's not about playing it safe as a record label. It's about pushing boundaries. Do you know what I mean? Like releasing stuff like Jesus fucking Christ. Like when when my our friend Dan Carr, who does Radio 1, I always like, you got to check out this band. Like if you can play them, that'd be cool. And he was like, oh, I'm really into it, but there's no way I can play someone called Jesus fucking Christ on BBC Radio. And he did, and he called it JFC. Like, there was a way around it.
That's sort of what F fucked up do. They do effed up whenever they want to do commercial releases.
But effed up's one thing. Jesus fucking Christ is something
JFC.
Else.
JFC! Sounds like KF. Well, yeah, it practically is. But, I don't know. It's difficult for a label sometimes when you're not working within the confines of a scene. I mean, we all grew up getting into music in the 90s, where Victory Records, as an example, really had hardcore and straight edge on lock. You know, if you liked Earth Crisis, Snapcase, Strife, Warzone, it had that bulldog logo on it, and you knew it was a sign of good hardcore, right? And it was that kind of music. For us, for Venn, we don't just promote one kind of scene. We're not a hardcore label. We're not a, like, Jesus fucking Christ, electro label. We just put out anything we like. So I think we ask people who subscribe to Venn Records and our releases less to be involved in a certain scene, but more just kind of like, I don't know, like...
Open their minds.
Yeah, and like, kind of like just trust their peers, because we're all peers, you know, we're all the same. We listen to the bands we put out, and so it's just like, just open your mind a bit. Hopefully with Venn, by not painting ourselves into a certain scene, we're not going to end up chasing those golden years that I think certain labels who have a specific roster might.
Well, let's talk a little bit about Gallows, I guess. You guys have been a band for 10 years now, which is about as long as Black Flag and The Clash, which is, you know... do you ever think a band would go on that long?
When you started?
No idea. Like,
let's be honest. When we started the band, we didn't think we'd go on 2 fucking weeks, let alone 10 years.
What's that like now that you have, like, you ever reflect on it and think?
I don't know how real you want to be here. Gallows is a band that went from playing dives to touring the world in arenas to Rage Against the Machine to headlining 3,000 cat rooms to back to playing dives. We've literally done the ups and the downs, and we're still here. And all I would hope someone took from that is that we were never here for those arena shows and for that sold out London Forum. That wasn't what kept us going. That wasn't our goal, because we've done it, and now we're playing the Cat House in Glasgow tonight, and we're still having just as much fun doing it. I think that the reason that the four of us get on stage is pretty much for the four guys on stage. We do it for us, and it's, I'm not going to say a blessing, because I'm not religious and I don't believe in that, fuck God and everything, but it is luck. It's really, we're really lucky to be able to do it where people like yourself want to come and talk to us about it.
I think if the music means more to you than everything else, then you're going to just carry on because you want to make music together, not because you want to make money, not because you want to be famous. And I think with some people, that kind of shit can like cloud their vision, and they're like, oh no, I'd rather make music to be famous, to make money. Whereas for us, we make music because we want to make music. Do you know what I mean? We want to like make interesting albums. We've never ever, like, the whole history of Gallows, we've never ever subscribed to a certain scene or style. Like, every single record we've made has stood out individually, and there's bands who just keep recording the same album over and over again, and you know, like, for them it's like, oh, if we change our sound we're going to lose a load of fans, whereas for us,
just don't give a shit.
Yeah, we change our sound because we want to, not because like we're like, we don't keep, what I'm trying to say, we don't like sound the same all the time because we want to play it safe. We change our sound because we as individuals want to make music that excites us.
That's it. And I want to say to anyone listening to this, is like, oh, you say you never want to, you know, go commercial, but you did do that single with Lethal Bizzle. The reason we did that single with Lethal Bizzle genuinely is because we're all fans of grime and we all listen to grime, and at the time, and you know, maybe he still is to a certain degree, Lethal Bizzle was like the king of grime, was killing it in London. And when you have an opportunity to work with one of your favourite artists, be it Simon from Biffy Clyro guesting on Grey Britain to doing a single with Lethal Bizzle, of course you're going to grab that opportunity with both hands. You know, that's not about selling as many records as you can, man. That's about coming from a shitty suburb town of London and being able to work with people that you really admire. That's what that was about.
I mean, you were getting no argument from me, like, you do what you want to do, like, that's just the way it is. I think a lot of people get attached to bands, and then they have that attitude of, well, they're kind of my band, so they shouldn't do it. Yeah. Everybody does it.
Totally guilty of it. I mean, some of my favourite bands that have changed the odd member, and I'm like, ah, fuck them, you know. Sepultura, I remember being 14 years old at a playground at a school, reading, I don't know, Kerrang or Metal Hammer or something, and being gutted when I got the news that Max was leaving Sepultura. And but it's one of those things. As a fan, you kind of don't understand what's going on behind the scenes, you know. But really, it probably was the best thing for them at the time, you know.
You kind of touched on it a little bit a second ago. I was going to ask it, but since you've brought it up, it's probably a good idea to bring it up now. This is the second album we made, obviously, and you seem to be exploring new stylistic territory. So that was a conscious decision then, to try and do something that excites you?
I think with everything Gallows do, it's never a conscious decision. It's always an organic decision. It's something that just happens, and it always happens naturally. Like, you know, we could be talking about like any kind of music. Do you know what I mean? Like, we listen to loads of like hip hop and stuff like that, electronic music. Like, if you were to be in the van when we were on tour, like, you know, most of the time we're not just listening to like goth rock or punk and hardcore. Like, we're listening to like Major Lazer and Bloody Beetroots and stuff like that. And you know, it's we just go out there, we just make music just for the fun of it, and you know, if it was not fun, we wouldn't do it.
I think a lot of friends that I know that are fans of Gallows have been wondering, well, where did that come from? Do you know what I mean? Like, why was that suddenly slightly darker and more gothic?
That's, I just think, you know, it comes from when you're growing up. You've got to understand, when we recorded Orchestra of Wolves, we were in our early 20s. We'd been in bands that had had some kind of touring experience, but not outside of the UK, and certainly not to any level where anyone gave a shit. Okay, I think the biggest tour my old band ever did was supporting Bane, and what did you went out with some fat rec bands or something. And it was just a thing. I think when Wade joined the band, Gallows had some like worldly experience. You start growing up, basically becoming a man a bit. And Wade coming in from the experience that Alexis on Fire had, not just in Canada but worldwide, I think you start looking at it as a way of wanting to explore more to it than just like beatdowns or fast parts. Just a bit of emotion, really, a bit of feeling. And I think for Gallows, we've always been angry, pissed off people, but you can only scream at the top of your lungs until you get sick of the sound of your own voice. And I think we started to explore the mood less in how harsh we scream and a bit more in just the way we play our guitars, the way that the drums are played and the lyrics are conveyed. Not every word in a song has to be a fuck you or a cunt or a, oh, I had a shitty day today, fuck the world. You know, you got to take a bit of responsibility. And sometimes what I find in the new lyrics are, I think Wade's talking more about himself, like taking a bit more responsibility, and the music that Lags is writing on guitar has just a bit more mood conveyed through just tones rather than just balls out, kick your head in shit.
Yeah, because it seems to me like it's still, well, Lags did say in an interview like about the last album, how it was like, you guys are still pissed off, you had something to prove. Now you guys are still pissed off, but it's like, well, let's be a bit more esoteric about it. We can still be pissed off, but, you know, it's also quite broody.
Yeah, like we don't really have anything to prove anymore. Do you know what I mean? Like, I feel like the first few records proved everything that ever needs to be proven.
Does
like,
a band ever really need to prove anything?
A band shouldn't. Yeah, exactly. Do you know what I mean? A band should just make music. Like, I think people kind of paint bands like how they see them, and so they expect the bands to do a certain thing and behave a certain way. Like, you know, we're not puppets. Like, we're individuals who control all our creative moods. Like, you know, our palette is our guitars, our instruments, and like, you know, we paint what the fuck we want, basically.
That's it. We're just painting from. That's actually the perfect answer to your last question, is how did that mood change? And I think the perfect answer to that is we're now actually painting just from a much broader palette. We're from everyone in the band's life experience and everything that's gone on. We're not just limited to these six or seven colours that we had when we were 19. We're now, you know, we're travelled world weary dudes, and we can paint from so many more colours, and that's kind of the picture we're trying to illustrate.
Yeah. Speaking of, like, you guys now have four albums, and you've got you've covered quite a lot of ground, I guess, like punk, metal, now kind of more, I guess, gothy parts. How do you approach like building a set list now?
It's a good question you ask, because we're going on stage in about 1 hour and we still argue about our set list. We do. We've never been a band that rehearsed things generally. When we were all in the same country, when Gallows was a band of guys who lived in the same town, we would probably rehearse twice a year if we went on tour. Generally, that's because we toured a lot. But also because we just don't really put that much thought into ebb and flow. You don't get a light show with us, so you don't have to consider lighting cues. We don't have any stage production. You don't have to consider that. All we need to consider is what we feel like when we tread those boards, what's going to like kick someone in the teeth the minute we go on stage, and how are we going to keep up that feeling of getting kicked in the face until we get off it.
The reason I ask is because it always interests me how the bands, obviously, especially when you're releasing your stuff, which is different from what you've done before. I wonder if you ever get reticent about performing older songs, especially since you've now got a different singer. If you ever get reticent about performing older songs, because it doesn't represent how you sound or how you've evolved now, if that makes sense. So I wonder if you ever struggle, you know, with
how much of the old stuff, how much of the new stuff, how much of the new album, how much of the old albums do they want to play?
I think the old songs still have a good vibe though. I mean, there's always going to be like older Gallows songs that are going to work really well live, and like we're not going to be idiots and deny that. Do you know what I mean? Like, we're here to play music for ourselves, but you know, we want everyone to have a good time, so we're going to throw in some classics in the set. But you're right, at the same time, we do like, you know, we feel like we're having the most fun when we're playing the new ones, to be honest. And
I think fun's the key word. I think what you got to realise is, other than a vocalist, the band now that's going on stage tonight is the same, exactly the same four bands that recorded Orchestra Walls. You know, Steph wasn't on it. So fun is the key word. You can't have loads of fun playing the same songs for 10 years. Because you'll just end up going through the motions, right? So we switch up our... We try and keep it fun for the crowd by keeping songs that we know that they're going to enjoy. But really, we're here to kind of show off, really, and express on our new songs. If you want to hear the old songs, you should have come and seen us on tour any time in the last decade.
I guess that's a great answer. I think a lot of people like need to hear that from bands sometimes. Like, this is like, you know, we've changed and... just deal with it, really.
Yeah,
like,
but you know. If you didn't change, you'd have people saying, oh, it's the same fucking record again. And if you do change, yeah, people are like, oh, it's not the band that I like. But I feel like your fan base grows as well. So for every... what? How old are we now? Like mid-30s?
Getting there, yeah.
Right? So, and so the band, we started the band in like early 20s. Kids that got into Gallows when Orchestra Walls came out, they're not even listening to guitar-driven music anymore. They're probably going to EDM raves, or if they've got any taste, listening to things like Tears for Fears and, you know, proper bands. Yeah. And I think so. It's a new wave of kids coming through, listening to heavy music. And to them, get with Spotify and everything you've got now that we didn't have originally, Orchestra Walls is probably a new record. Great Britain's a new record. Our self-titled record is a new record to them. So I don't like to think of it as old songs. I just think it's a new tour.
Given how much ground you've covered, sort of musically, genre-wise, who are some of the musicians you kind of look up to that have kind of paved the way for like the kind of stuff you've done now and also in the past? Like, who are like the main sort of drivers behind the
main influences? J.R. Ewan was definitely one when it came to Orchestra Walls. Can we do it per album? Because there's definitely been people we've bitten per album.
I just mean like in your life generally, which made you want to kind of do it. Right.
I think that, you know, there's bands like Cavan when they just completely switched their sound. Do you know what I mean? Like, this, they do everything is fucking sick. Doesn't matter what they're doing, and so you know it's. Yeah, you know, I totally reckon they got
Cave-In, definitely. If anyone listens to the podcast has never checked out Cave-In,
why the fuck not?
Do the whole discography. Yeah, first of all, why the fuck not? And do the whole discography. And while we're on that kind of like Massachusetts tip, linked to Cave-In, Converge has definitely been a big influence on us, the way they approach playing live and writing their records. A huge thing. I mean, Nirvana, obviously, just because of the time we grew up. That's been a huge influence on us and the way we all play music, I think. I don't know. And really obscure Scandinavian bands, I could say, but no one would have heard them.
That's the interesting shit, though, because if that's the stuff that made you want to pick up a guitar or make music, then that's the kind of shit everybody wants to hear about. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, well, J.R. Ewing, definitely. Anyone listening to this who's never heard J.R. Ewing, who had records out in Coalition... please, please, please check them out. They don't even play distorted guitars, and that was a key thing that we had on Orchestra Walls, I feel like, wasn't it? With your guitar tones.
Looking back, it didn't really work on some tracks, but it was definitely a vibe when we went in there. Do you know what I mean? It's like, yeah, we want to keep it super clean, and then it's like, oh, we're gonna have a breakdown on Bed of a Shark, and it sounds really like twangy.
But anyway. But, and that's kind of, we kind of hit that sound by accident. So it's all about having a clean tone but playing it as hard as you can. Orchestra Walls has no distortion on the guitars, that's why I had a distorted bass. But in your head, you probably think, what's this bloke talking about? Orchestra Walls have distorted guitars. It doesn't actually, it's actually totally clean. It's just Lags is playing it till his fingers bled so hard, it sounds heavy.
We basically cranked all the amps as loud as they could go, so if there's any kind of distortion, it was like a natural one, as opposed to sticking an overdrive pedal in front of everything.
Yeah. I don't know, man. Every band you've ever listened to, I guess you'd call an influence. It's,
I hate it when you do an interview with a band and go, oh, well, we really took influence from X band or Y band. It's everything that you've ever heard from the minute your mum was driving you to school listening to Stevie Wonder cassettes to the day that fucking Downset dropped an album. Do you know what I mean? It's everything in between.
That's why I hate asking the influence question, because it's like, well, you kind of need to be a bit more specific if you've got to figure out like what piece of...
It's a valid question, you know? But I think just life is the influence, isn't it?
I guess that's the best answer as well, I suppose. So, when you kind of talked a little bit about it, but I just wanted to drill down a little deeper into it. When did you guys realise, holy shit, this is happening, this is a full-time thing that we want to do now?
First when we...
you remember the moment?
This has never been publicly broadcast, the whole going one direction, getting a phone call and going in the other.
What you're talking about, the late measure.
Yeah, well, that's what you're asking, that's from the holy shit moment.
No, I just meant, like, obviously, but when you started, you guys toured a lot on Orchestra Wolves. So you must have made a decision at some point to go, fuck it, we're doing it.
We're doing Orchestra Wolves. I remember everyone around us kept saying, like, you know, we did a tour of Similar Paramedics and D-Rail. And they were like...
We remain supportive of Similar Paramedics.
Yeah. And they were both like, you guys have really got something going on here. And we were like,
Thing we've got going on is a couple of beers.
Yeah. And, you know, like, it was weird, like, you know, we'd play some gigs with November Coming Fire, and like, they were like, oh, we want to take you guys out. And, you know, we'd show up to the gigs and there's more people there to see us than them. And promoters coming up to us at the end of the night going like, I'm really sorry, like, everyone's, you know, everyone who's paid in has said they want to see you, but we've already had a guarantee for NCF that we've got to pay them this amount, you can only get this amount. And we were just like, this is so weird, like, what's going on? And then it kind of just spirals, and as it's happened, you don't see it, like, you don't, you're not, it's like you're not there, you're just kind of like, oh, you're just doing the same thing you always do, whereas...
Yeah, it was really weird. We were playing to the same crowd that we did. When we're playing London, we're playing hardcore all day on bills with some great bands, you know. We got lucky enough to play with Striking Distance when they came over, and Cold World at the Dome, and I remember that being like the last hardcore all day we ever played. And I remember actually feeling a bit heartbroken that, like, coming from the hardcore scene, playing hardcore bands my whole life, and this is my first hardcore day of show with Gallows that we played, and I love Striking Distance, and the whole crowd just hated us. And we'd always get put in these hardcore days as a gap filler, and I was like, oh, like, no, I guess we're shit. I guess no one likes us. And like Lag says, we go on a couple of tours with, I guess, bands that, like, November Coming Fire definitely, on the hardcore end of the spectrum, have a more broad mind, open-minded fan base, for sure. As did Similar Paramedics. So when we play in front of their crowds, people kind of got it, didn't they? And then I guess we'd announce our own shows in, like, back rooms of pubs, and we'd end up filling a 100-cap back room of a pub, and I was like, holy fucking shit, we sold 30 demos today. That's when we thought we'd made it. Honestly, that was when we thought, fuck me, like, 30 people give a shit about our band.
But even then, you're not making money, do you know what I mean? Like, it's not a case of...
Get man.
Yeah, it's not a case of, like, oh, we can just quit our jobs and carry on, because, you know, obviously, like, I remember Lee was working, Stu was working. I'd actually quit work because I was going on tour, like, just doing merch for bands, like, and getting paid £15 just to do merch. And I was... Every venue, I'd give the promoter, like, a Gallows demo. And I think they all probably just binned them. Do you know what I mean? It's like, never heard of them. Fuck it.
Yeah.
But
is there any trepidation about doing that? Like, making that leap going?
I was lucky enough to work for my family business. I think Lags had a job he hated, so was quite willing to give it up.
Well, I didn't mind. I was working at Borders.
You were getting loads of Playboys in the bathroom for free. I remember you telling me about that. But no, we got really lucky in the fact that we got in a... It was all about timing. At the end of the day, there are so many amazing bands in the world, far more talented than us and far more deserving, who didn't hit the timing and didn't get there. And I think we have to kind of give that some kind of acknowledgement. I think a lot of bands, and I could name one or two that are big at the moment, that are British rock bands, who are killing it and don't acknowledge the fact that they're just a product of good timing, and there's way better bands bigger than them. So I don't know. I think, I guess, the first time we had our name written on the cover of Kerrang was like a bit of a moment. Not because we give a shit about it, but that was just like I could show it to my mum and be like, look, there's a reason why I'm a fucking dropout.
Yeah, it's weird because, you know,
it's tangible.
you might be now thinking like, oh yeah, like all those magazines are a bit passe or whatever, but when you're a kid buying Kerrang! Magazine, like I remember getting it like Kurt Cobain on the cover and things like that, you're
I'd be shocked if anyone listening is thinking this hadn't had those magazines when they were younger.
Yeah, but exactly. We were quite old when it happened, so I had a band get a great review in Fracture fanzine before I had a Kerrang! Front cover, so I didn't think it was the right way as far as I'm concerned. Like, fuck the scene. Like, we never really cared about the punk rock snobs thinking, like, they didn't like us anyway.
Yeah, so Monk Dave.
We had nothing to lose by...
This one goes out to Monk Dave in Wales.
By people, and Nick Javad, by people covering us in Kerrang! It's not like we lost the fan base, because we never had... The underground punk scene never backed us.
It's quite interesting, because I the first hardcore record I ever had was Second American Nightmare Records.
Right, yeah.
Background Music.
Yeah.
And I got that because of a good review in Kerrang!
That was the first ever tour I ever did. In my old band, Wintering June, we went on tour with American Nightmare. We played Canterbury Scout Hut in 1999. I want to say with Sworn In and Kanan. And those were the good days. But
yeah, just reminded me of how many good bands like Seven Part and Felix and Beach and Derail
forgotten
about.
That's how we knew about those guys, because we'd always go to shows to see all these bands that come over. And you would go. We would go to Leeds. We'd go to the 1 in 12. We'd go to Bradford. You know, Sheep would put on shows all the time up north. And you just go. We'd go and see fucking... Oh, what was that? Imbalance or whatever. And you wouldn't think twice about travelling that distance to see it. So that's how, when Gallows was putting out a demo, we were able to get shows. Because we knew the promoters, just because we would travel the country just as kids going to shows.
Yeah.
And I don't know, Matt. I think the history of the UK punk rock scene and stuff... It's a weird one for Gallows, because we're almost kind of hated by that kind of the collective zine, the people who go to shows at the 1 in 12. But we were going to those gigs, man. We just got... Kerrang! Wrote about... We didn't ask Kerrang! To write about us. Do you know what I mean? They just did. And then we were the bad guys.
And now you're here with a record that sounds nothing like the ones that everybody loved, like Kerrang! Loved, that everybody, you know, that kind of thing. And it's funny how things change.
What did the new record get in Kerrangley?
Got four.
Four out of five. It's not bad.
Yeah, I hope they've grown up like as well. I somehow think it's totally different.
Well, it's an interesting story, because James McMahon, who's now the editor of Kerrang! Was the deputy editor of NME when we were coming up, wasn't he? And he was all about us. So it's interesting that as our journey's progressed, he's obviously doing well for himself as well. It's good to see people doing well for themselves.
Just to round it up, I guess, what are you guys going to do for the rest of the year now, after you've done Slam Dunk and all that, and the festivals and summer? Have you got anything else on that
you're excited about, other than just being...
I think we're going to do a lot more Venn releases and events and stuff. Like, we did a gig our first night with Moose Blood and Milk Teeth, and it sold out. It was really good. And then I started doing like three shows in London, where just to get people to see new bands. So we did one with Muskets and Reacher, which was amazing. And then,
is that how you pronounce it?
Reacher, yeah.
I've always done it as a Risher.
So yeah, I think
like, to Venn, the guy can't pronounce your band name.
More releases, more gigs.
You're getting into like, you're doing a lot more stuff in your other music, so don't be... I know you're really modest, but Lags is like actually quite an in-demand DJ for stuff. Obviously, Wade is smashing it in Canada, doing radio as a presenter and a DJ. And you know, I think these other elements of our lives, where we're not just focusing on being in a van playing shows, make it a lot more fun when we do get together to do things like this.
Yeah, because as soon as a band becomes a business, then it gets too serious, and that can really like damage for fun and creative vibes, and that's when monsters fucking get created and ruin it for everyone else. But like, as soon as you kind of remove that fact of a business side of things, and it's just about making music, playing a few shows whenever you can, then it kind of takes you back to when you first started doing a band, when it's all about like having fun and
that's exactly being it, with mates. It's about having fun. If there was any advice I could give to anyone who listens to your podcast who's like, how can I get my band signed and get popular, best advice would be stop trying to get signed. Just enjoy yourself.
There's actually a question that I was going to ask, but I decided not to ask. But can you, now you've said that, I might ask it. There seems to be quite a big thing just now. I don't know if you guys have noticed it in Britain, where there's been lots of bands that are just chucking money at PR and hoping something will happen. Have you guys noticed that, like, with bands that are...
I fucking noticed it. And yeah, I know a lot of people that work in PR, and they fucking love it.
Yeah.
And it's really, really easy to cut a check to someone every month who's promising you the world. It doesn't work like that, mate.
Yeah, that's what I was asking, because when you said what you said...
You've got to do it and you love it. At the end of the day, rather than you giving someone money to make your band big, just keep doing what you're doing. Eventually someone will come knocking, writing you a check, if it's going to happen.
Well, thanks very much for that interview, guys. Have you guys got anything else you want to say before we're done?
I'd just like to say thanks to everyone for listening to the podcast. Check out venrecords.com. You can pick up sweet limited edition vinyl by Moose Blood, Milk Teeth, Lebanecris. You want me out here on the band you've released.
Crooks, Jesus fucking Christ.
Jesus Christ. Gallows as well, obviously.
It's going to be new Reacher, new Muskets, new Sleep Beggar. Lots of cool stuff happening. New Carnival Kids.
Just go to vimrecords.com. We put all the Gallows news up on there.
Awesome. So, yeah. What do you think of that, then? It was pretty good, wasn't it? I mean, I thought it was good. While I was listening to that interview back, I thought, you know what? This is actually quite a good interview, and I think I'm maybe being a little bit too negative about myself in the past podcasts. So from now on, no more negativity. None. I'm just going to be proactive and, you know, positive. PMA, man. PMA, that's what they say. Anyway, thanks for checking that out. I don't really know what else to say. I think they've covered pretty much all the bases. Wonderful guys, wonderful band, good attitude, and a lot of good views on punk, which kind of align with my own, I guess you could say. So yeah, as ever, rate us on iTunes, review us on iTunes, subscribe via iTunes, via Stitcher, whatever podcasting app that you use. Please rate and review this on iTunes. It has made a huge difference. I'm now in the top 100, new and noteworthy, as I said, but I want to get higher up that list. I want to be on the front page. That'd be amazing. So if you could help me out with that, I would appreciate it so, so much. You can like us on Facebook, The Curator Podcast, Twitter, The Curator Pod, SoundCloud, The Curator Pod, all of them. Drop me an email if you want with some feedback. That's hi@thecuratorpodcast.com. I'm having a lot of fun doing this. I have a couple more interviews lined up, and we'll just kind of go from there. This is me going to play out with another Gallows song. This is from their last album, because I had to play this because it's one of my favourite songs, and when they played it live, it was utterly devastating. So yeah, this song is called Cross of Lorraine, and I hope you enjoy it. Until next time, guys. Bye-bye. True that I'd be dead.
Warning!